just waiting here for you, for the fire. If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. Come with expectation, waiting here for you.
Mom, you're thankful. I've been praying for quite some time to have a worship leader in this house.
Amen.
Amen.
Thankful for my spiritual son, Pastor Alex. Thank you.
Yes.
This morning, or this afternoon, I know I keep saying this morning, it's morning somewhere, amen. Marks years of prayers. I have asked for years, why don't I have a regular church? This is a desire of my heart. And I will tell you this without going into detail, sometimes you got to be obedient even when it doesn't seem like it's the right decision to make.
Amen.
Sometimes you got to go against your flesh, go against your emotion, and go against ties that have been there for a long time. You got to listen to the Lord.
Amen.
When the Lord says move on, you move on. Amen.
Amen.
When the Lord says tear, he told the prophet Jeremiah, he said, I have called you, I have ordained you a prophet to the nation. He said, I want you to tear down, and then he said, I want you to go in and to build and to plant.
Yes.
How many of you know in Greenwood we're still in the tearing down stage?
Yeah. Yeah.
There is a religious stranglehold in this city, if you haven't noticed. Amen. There are people who are looking for truth, but all they get is some warmed over sermon on their behavior. Amen.
Right.
Your behavior will change as you get into the presence of God.
Amen.
I could get on you all day about your behavior. You could get on it with mine. But if I teach you how to tap into the anointing of God, your behavior will change.
Amen.
There, the problem with most of the church is that they have been touched by the fire, but never changed by the fire of God.
That's good.
They've been touched by the power of God, never changed by the power of God. To be changed by the fire and the power of God, you've got to stay and submit yourself to that for a long period of time.
Amen.
You have got to decide like Jesus, not my will, but your will be done.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 2. We're just going to uplift you a little bit this morning. I'm just in awe of what God is doing here. Amen.
Amen.
Who would have thunk it? 2 Chronicles chapter 2. Talk to you about the dedication of the tent. Does somebody have something in the spirit? Somebody have something? All right. 2 Chronicles 2, verse 1. You had your chance. 2 Chronicles 2, verse 1. It said, it's Solomon determined. Everybody say determined.
Determined.
That's a good word to bring to the body of Christ nowadays, is to be determined. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes we see the men on television and we think that they just started preaching from the avenue of television and flying a plane. Not so. Some of them started out very much like we did in the living room or somewhere else. And it said, and Solomon determined to build a house for the name of the Lord and a house for his kingdom. So let me explain to you, first of all, Solomon said, I have determined I will build a house for the Lord. I have determined years and years ago that I would build a house for the Lord. When I realized that I was called not to be an evangelist and travel around, but I was called to be a pastor, that I had a pastor's heart to bring truth, to shape people, that the light went off in me, and the Lord began to show me what we call revival in the church really is everyday Christianity according to the Bible.
Amen. Amen.
See, we think some great thing has happened, and it is a great thing when people get healed, they get set free, but that should be the norm in our Christian life.
Yes.
Wherever we go, demons should tremble, the power of God should resonate, and the captive should be set free.
Amen. Amen.
In Luke 4:18, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Everybody go, me.
Me.
And he said, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel.
Yes.
He has sent me to preach deliverance to the captive.
Amen.
He sent me to heal the brokenhearted.
Yes.
He has sent me to open blinded eyes.
Yes.
Really, if you got down to it, you could say Jesus' sermons were all about me. But when you get into the New Testament and find out who you are in Christ, that you are in Christ, Christ is in you, the anointing of the Anointed One, that Luke 4:18 now applies to you.
Yes.
There is no situation that should consume the New Testament believer.
Amen.
Hosea 4:6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Most people have no idea what belongs to them in Christ. Don't have any idea of the character of God. They don't understand that we're up here. We are now, Ephesians 2 says we are now seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's my position as a Christian legally.
Amen.
And it said if Solomon determined to build a house for the Lord years ago when I found out I had a call to pastor, what broke my heart how I found out that I was called to pastor, I was sitting in a church listening to this man vomit religious filth on these people of God who had come to hear the message of truth. Sincere people wanting help.
Yes.
And my heart started to break and tears welled up in my eyes. And the Lord brought me back to that passage about Jesus where he was sitting overlooking Jerusalem and he wept and he said, how long have I desired to gather you under my wings, but you wouldn't let me. The Lord said, I'm birthing in you today a pastor's heart. And I said, well, what do I do? He said, undo the lies of religion and bring the power of the truth to the Word. And I determined then that I would build a house for God. The church that we had would look like the church of the book of Acts. That from time to time we would get caught up in a whirlwind of the wind of the Spirit. And content to sit in the pew, but we would knock down the walls and go find the broke and the hurt and the lost. And that here in our midst, the sick would be healed, the poor would be fed, the naked would be clothed, and the religious would be set free into a relationship with the Almighty. He determined to build a house for the Lord. Here's where most people get off balance. Here's where we will not. They determined to build a house for everything and everybody but the Lord. They want to build a ministry for them, for their organization. They want to quit slinging hash at the local eatery. But they don't determine. Solomon said, I have determined to build a house for the Lord. Everything that we do here at 2911 is based for the Lord, never for me, never for anything or anybody else. I tell them this. That there are only three people at any given time the spotlight should be on here in this house. That's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Anything else is off balance. Well, then, Brother David, great. Not if you knew me away from here, out from under the anointing. I'm kind of a jerk. Well, isn't he great? Isn't he wonderful? Well, you wouldn't want to know him apart from God. But isn't he great? Isn't he wonderful? He determined, he had a determination, he had decided, when I build this great, glorious temple, it will be to honor the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's where we've gone wrong in the modern day church. We want our ministry, our name, our letters, our agenda, our talents. The only thing that separates talent is anointing. One is consecrated to God, the other one's for show to get a rise out of people. Bible says you had your reward when that's you. And then it said he had determined to build a house for the Lord and for his kingdom. Notice, he wasn't talking about Solomon's kingdom. He was talking about building a house where the kingdom of God could be instituted on this earth.
Yes.
Where the things of God could be learned and carried on for generations to come.
Amen.
And so my prayer here in this new place at 502 West Denver, is that the right address? Woo, thank God. I'd hate to miss it and have God sitting out there waiting for me. But at this new place, 502 West Denver, my prayer is this. Not that God come in intermittently and meet with us, but my prayer is from the time we open the door that he is here waiting on us. Not God, this would be a place you would visit, but this would be a place where your presence would dwell.
Yes.
And well, how are we going to do that? We got to get motive and purity of heart first. Then we determine to build this house for him.
Amen.
To establish his kingdom on this earth, just like Solomon did.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That should be our prayer when we come here Tuesday. That's going to be a focus of our prayer. We're going to pray for salvation for the city of Greenwood, for their eyes to open, for the light of the gospel to shine to them. But we are going to invite. How many of you know, if you don't invite me to your house, I'm not going to show up and plop down on your couch and eat Cheetos. But if you invite me, You may be wishing I would leave. I'll clean you out of house and home if you got ice cream. See, God doesn't just dwell in a place by right. He dwells there, first of all, when he's invited. Listen, the Bible says don't grieve the Spirit of God. If you read that whole thing about grieving the Spirit of God, it has to do how we interact as believers.
Yes, yes.
Right. See, how I treat Brother Alex, Jesus takes it very personal.
Yes,
you remember when Paul got knocked off the horse, he said, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He didn't say, "Why are you bothering the church?"
Yep.
And he said, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God. That's why in the church body, we got to keep our motives and our mouths and our mind pure about everybody here.
Amen.
Once you have an offense against leadership, you have the makings of a bomb that will destroy the church.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. But he said, I have determined that I will build a house for the Lord and for his kingdom for generations to come.
Lord.
Here at 2911, we're going to start on Tuesday. God doesn't just show up and go, hey, can you let me in? I'd like to visit with you. He is invited, and then when he is invited and he shows up, he is welcome to do whatever it is that he wants to do.
Amen. That's right. Come on.
Well, I don't know, man. That was a lot of songs, but you ain't seen nothing yet.
Right.
We will learn in the modern day church how to wait on the presence of Almighty God.
Amen.
We will learn to hear the voice of God and not move until he says
Amen.
Move. Remember, did I ever tell you the story about a young evangelist that was invited to China, and he went to their underground church. It was 8 in the morning, and he said, how long do I, when is service over? He said, 8:30 at night. He said, my God, when do we take lunch? He said, we don't. They're hungry for the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
And he said, they will not move till they hear a word from God. They will not move. 12.5 hours. When he was done, they said, can you come back tomorrow? He said, what time? They said, 8 o'clock. He said, when are we done? 8:30. He said, same deal, same deal.
Amen.
Modern day Church of America, we want God's money, we want God's healing, we want the fame and fortune, but we can't sit an hour in God's presence till we're ready to get out of God and go do our life.
Come on.
See, once he's invited here and his presence dwells here, we've got to make the atmosphere conducive for him to feel welcome.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's good stuff.
That's good.
Let's move on. Seems like we went into meddling a little bit. Verse 2 is that in Solomon told out 70,000 men to bear burdens, and 80,000 to hew in the mountain, and 3,600 to oversee them. Understand this, that everybody, and you've heard it before, but everybody in the body of Christ has a unique function in the upkeep and the prosperity and the ongoing of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
There, it said Solomon determined he was going to build a temple. It was going to be for the glory of the Lord, that his kingdom could be established, that people could come and meet with the Creator. And then he said, here's what I've got to do. I've got to find out. Listen, here at 2911, I promise you, the only reason you don't function and move in ministry is because you don't want to.
Amen.
Let me get over here.
Say it again.
The only reason here at 2911 you don't do something in the ministry is because you don't want to. You can't give up your precious time and your precious life.
Amen.
Yeah, but I have a life. Jesus said, to find the higher life, you better lose your life. What does that mean? That means everything else must come second place to his desire. And in that, you will find fulfillment. It said that there were so many that were cutting out rocks, so many that moved boulders, so many that moved dirt. Here is where the responsibility falls on your part. There are some of you I've been waiting on a long time to figure out the potential that's inside of you.
Amen.
I've been waiting for some of you to come and say, Pastor, there is something I want to do.
Amen.
And it said some were called to cut the rocks, some to cut the beams, some to move the dirt. There were some that were called to be leaders upon them. All of you are not called to be leaders, but some of you will start out hoeing rock, moving dirt, and you will become a leader over those that
Amen.
Remember, I told you the road to the pulpit starts with a dollar toilet in a can of bleach.
Amen.
Bleach doesn't come in a can, but bear with me. If it did come in a can. But here is your obligation. This is not a spectator sport.
Yes.
You are not coming here watching a tennis match between me and the devil.
Amen.
You are here to get equipped, Ephesians 4,
Amen.
So that you can do the work of the ministry.
Amen. Amen.
You are not ordained to sit on your hind end till the rapture.
That's right.
Amen.
You are called to come in here and find out, am I a hewer of rock? Am I the one that cuts the brick? Am I the leader over thousands? Who am I, God?
Mom.
Right.
That's good.
I will tell you this, 29:11 is this one place where you will be celebrated rather than tolerated.
Amen. Amen.
Whatever your weakness is will be swallowed up by the strength of the Almighty.
Amen. Amen.
Whatever your strengths are, we will exploit them and use them for the kingdom of God to throw the net far and wide.
Praise God.
Wow. Brother Mark Hankins, I don't know if you know who he is, but he made a statement years ago. He said, here's your job. You get on your face, you find your place, and you run your race.
Yes.
Come on. That's good stuff.
Amen.
Yeah. Want to build a house for the Lord so His name is great? Then get on your face.
Yes.
Find your place. Run your race. In other words, don't be content to sit and watch me do everything. Find out where you fit in. If you're just a mover, a rock, then bless God, move that rock so we can keep building and go forward.
Yes.
If you are the leader, then come and get direction, then lead Him properly with the right heart.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good stuff.
Yeah.
He said, get on your face, find your place, and run your race. Here, listen, I'm good at a lot of things. You can ask my wife. I'll make you go, wow. Don't ask her. That's a lie. Lord, forgive me. But I found something. I found one thing I'm good at, okay? I found one thing I am good at, okay? But I find this is what I fail at every time. That's trying to be you or to fill your place or to be somebody that I'm not.
That's right.
You know, years ago, I felt ashamed because I thought, man, I ought to grow some hair. Look, I took out my earrings for everybody, okay? Feel like, man, I ought to grow some hair, wear a suit, and put on some nice, I ought to be, I ought to look respectable. I'm a pastor. Then I decided that, man, I'm not called to those kind of people, quote unquote.
Praise God.
Hey, what do you mean by that, Pastor? Well, if I do that, I'm uncomfortable in my skin. Okay, that's not who I am.
That's right. Come on.
See, I will fail at being somebody else every time.
Amen.
But where I will excel is when God has made me who I am, and I fit comfortably in there and realize that in that place resides the power and the secrets of the kingdom.
Amen.
Amen. I can't swoop my hair like Benny Hinn. I can't do it. I'm not comfortable in a three-piece suit.
Thank God.
I like tattoos and Christian rap music, all right? That's me. My pants might not fit as tight as some of those other guys. But I'm not comfortable in that. Why? Because I realized years ago, I got to find out, am I a hewer of rock? Am I a mover of dirt? Am I a leader among men? And if I am that, I can't compare myself among others.
That's
because
right.
There I will fall
That's
short.
Good.
I measure myself against what God has revealed
Amen.
In His Word. That's
Amen.
My measuring stick.
Amen.
Come on.
I found out a long time ago where the frustration lied, trying to be like Copeland or Hagin or one of them. And I realized, wait a minute, my goal is to be like Jesus.
Amen.
They're great men, don't get me wrong, but that is not who I'm called to be like. I'm called to be like Jesus.
Yes.
The book of Romans says that my job is to be conformed, pressed into the mold of Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
We have schools today cranking out cookie cutter cutouts of the big preachers.
Yep.
But the intention of the gospel was to put a bunch of cookie cutter cutouts of Jesus all over the world.
Amen.
Let's go on with 2 Chronicles 7. Just give you a little hors d'oeuvres this morning. Is that all right?
Amen. Yeah.
2 Chronicles 7, verse 1, and we'll tie it up right here. I hope you understand. We came to Greenwood to put down some roots and stay a while.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 7, verse 1.
2 Corinthians or Chronicles?
Who cares? You'll figure it out. 2 Chronicles 7. Pray, sister, pray. God will reveal all things. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 1. Following the same story, Solomon had decided he was going to build a temple to honor the Lord and bring honor and glory to His name. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 1, it said, "Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house." Let me tell you this. When things are right in 29:11 in this body, when our motives, our relationship, our thoughts, our actions, our intentions are correct, it will be followed by the supernatural moving of Almighty
Amen.
God.
Amen.
It said Solomon, he determined he was going to build a house that was going to honor the Lord, and then he did his part. He went into that house and he prayed and began to seek the heart of God. And it said, as he sought God's heart, that's why we're here on Tuesday. That's why we fast. I don't want another dead religious structure.
Amen.
I want a
Amen.
Place consumed by the fire and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
That's what I want. I want a place that at some point when people come in, they weep and they fall down and say, "Man, I need God. I need God.
Yes.
My desire is that before we ever preach one word, people are at the altar being saved, healed, filled with the Spirit." That's my desire. And it said he had determined, see, his motives were right in the beginning. He said, "I'm going to build a house for God. It will honor you. It will honor you. It will honor you."
Yes, Lord.
No matter whose name is on the incorporation papers, it's all done for an audience of one.
That's it.
Yes, sir. That's
yes,
right. Sir. Come
and
on.
He said he came and he sought the Lord. He started to seek the Lord. That's why we instituted praying. That's what's wrong with most of the church
Amen.
Today. They don't follow the biblical mandate of corporate prayer.
Yep.
Come on. They expect to parrot, confess 2 or 3 verses, and God give them the world on a shoestring. It doesn't work that way.
That's right.
And it said, Solomon, he came and he made an end of praying, and the fire of God fell from heaven.
Hallelujah.
I promise you, this year we're going to see things
Amen.
That we have desired to see for years and for years and for years. Say, how do you know? Well, he started with me in 2013 from Psalm 126 about we were like those that dream dreams, and then with our mouths, they were filled with laughter. He said, if you get lying, boys, let me get some things out of you. You'll walk. Have you ever woke up from a dream and go, "Is this real or am I dreaming? Did I dream that or did that really happen?" God wanted to do something so miraculous that you'd walk around like my wife and I when we got our house where we live and one of our cars and we were going, "Can you believe this? Well, this is like a dream. Pinch me." No, don't pinch me. You're hateful. And that's what God was saying in 2013, that if you will allow me to work through you, he said, they will come bearing precious seed, weeping. What is precious seed? There is bearing seed, and precious seed is when it hurts to give it.
Yes.
When I got nothing to give, this is all I've got in my hand.
Yes.
And I'm offering it to you. Whatever you can do with
yes.
that, it belongs to you. You gave it to me. I've got nothing else but this, and I offer it to you. And he said, you do that and you will walk around like those that dream dreams. Then will your mouth be filled with laughter? You would look back at all the devastation the devil tried to cause and you would say, "Ha ha, devil."
Yeah.
Ha ha ha.
Amen.
You tried to stop me. You tried to destroy me. But baby, when there was pain in the offering, I let it go. Now look at the heart. Is this real? Is this really happening? Can you believe all this? I got time to play with you, devil. And in 2014, he said this, it's a year of favor and vengeance that there will be poured out on the people of God, favor like never before, and the vengeance of our Lord to pay back disproportionately to the wrong that was done to them.
Yeah.
That God would take those of us with stained reputations and backgrounds and would begin to lift us up out of the pit and the miry clay, would put us on the forefront of ministry and give us a voice to the world.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow. Amen. Wow. Why, he determined to build a house for his Lord. A place where the presence of God could dwell
and be tangibly felt when we walked in.
That we don't have to come here and work up three songs and a little jig for the Lord to be pleased. Or when we come in, that for who we are inside, we have conformed our ways, our thoughts, our motives, and our words. And He is pleased to dwell in our midst. He said that Solomon, he prayed and the fire of God fell. Second verse. Verse 2. And the priest could not enter into the house because of the glory of the Lord had filled the house. In other words, there was such a reverential awe and fear of the Almighty. People were treading lightly.
Yeah.
See, you know when true revival hits, not because there's a bunch of people and we're shaking and grunting and groaning and acting like we're getting hit in the stomach. That's not how you know true revival hits. You know true revival hits when an awesome reverential fear of God, His Spirit, His leadership, His church, and His Word grips you to the core of who you are.
Yes.
That when you hear and see something in the Word, even if it's uncomfortable and corrected, you find a place of repentance. Listen, all of us sitting here, we should go out of here rejoicing because you are breathing. That means you are given another day, a space of repentance to get it right.
Amen.
That's why you are still here. God said, I know you're not perfect, but I'm going to give you a space to repent and to get it right.
Amen. Yes.
And it said they couldn't even enter because of the glory of the Lord. A reverential awe of fear gripped them.
Yes.
The presence of God was so thick. They didn't just bust into the presence of God, do three jigs, take everybody's money, confess two scriptures, and go home. They said there is something different at 29:11.
Yeah.
There is something there that I haven't felt anywhere else. There is something happening inside of me. And I've been in church my whole life, and I feel like the floodgates have been opened in my life. I've got vision, I've got purpose, I've got hope, and I've got eternal destiny in my
Amen.
Heart.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
After he dedicated it to the Lord, after he decided it was going to be the kingdom of God, and after he came in and prayed, after the Lord answered, after we came back to a reverential fear of God.
Amen.
Verse 3. It said, and when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down, and the glory of the Lord upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground above the pavement and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, for He is good, and His mercy endures forever. Understand this. I've said this, but it goes good here. Don't believe your own press reports, whether good or bad. Don't listen to people's opinions. They change like the wind. The opinion of who I am is founded in Acts to Revelation. That's who I am. I'm more than a conqueror. I'm a royal priesthood.
Yes. Yes.
I'm a chosen people. I'm a holy generation.
Yes.
Amen.
All I am is like a ventriloquist dummy. I'm just a dummy. I let God put His hand up my back. And He moves my mouth and fills my heart with the words.
Yes.
Beyond that, we've got problems. So don't set me too high up on a pedestal. I have just learned something that I want to carry on for generations. If we let God be God, it said these people bowed to the ground. They were in awe. They felt the power and the presence of the Almighty. They seen the greatness of God that had exploded in their midst. And they couldn't do anything. They did, wow, Pastor, you sure are great. Let's start a newsletter. They fell on the ground to their faces and said, my God, you are good and your mercy endures forever.
Yes.
You are good and your mercy endures forever.
Yes.
You are good and your mercy endures forever.
Yes.
Man.
How could you take a bunch of convicts and drug addicts and build such a beautiful place where your holiness dwells? You are good. And your mercy endures forever. How could you take people from every walk of life and bring them in here and make us into family? You are good and your mercy endures forever.
Come on.
How could you take broken lives and restore everything that had either been lost or given up or traded? You are good and your mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Wow. Hallelujah. A milestone today in 29:11. A milestone.
Yes.
Psalm 127:1 says this in the beginning. It says, unless the Lord builds the house, he that labors, labors in vain.
Amen. That's right. Come on.
Doesn't matter if you have 300,000 people in a $12 million building. That is not the mark of God.
That's right.
Come on, sir. The majority is not always right.
Amen.
To say this again, the majority of crucify him.
Yeah, that's right.
The majority mob mentality is not always right. But it said, unless the Lord builds a house, those that labor, labor in vain. When we get those principles right that I told you about in eternity, when it comes to the judgment seat of Christ, if we won't offer him wood, hay, and stubble from 29:11. Boy, we got a big building. We got a Bible school. Aren't we great? Toot, toot, toot your own little horn. But our motives have been pure from the beginning.
Thank you, Lord.
That we are here to invade a city to set the captive free.
Amen.
We are here to undo all. We are here to take people from the gutter and to bring them to the throne.
Amen.
Bring them from the dope houses into the house of the Almighty.
Amen. Amen. Come on, that's good.
For all the anointings that they had on their life that were perverted, they could flam, flam, shake, bake. Turn them into evangelists because they've got that gift of gab.
Amen. Come on.
Sell your own bunk dope back. God said that was just a perversion on the anointing that I put on your life.
That's right. That's right. Amen.
I will unfold the schemes of the enemy. It said those that labor, they labor in vain unless the Lord builds a house. You can get a group of businessmen together with a lot of money and have a pretty building, even be on TV and have a newsletter and have a magazine, but it doesn't mean the Lord built the house.
That's right.
You can get enough people together that have understanding and you can keep the machinery of ministry going far after the Spirit of the Lord has departed. How do you know when the Lord has built the house? Because he's in the house.
Yes.
Amen.
Well, how do you know when he's in the house? I'll share this with you and I'll let you go. I'm having too much fun. We could be here all day. Mark chapter 2 is talking about when they tore up the roof. Everybody should be familiar with that, right?
Yeah.
They tore up the roof to get their paralytic friend there. But if you read the very beginning, I think it's verse 1, it said, it was noised abroad that he was in the house.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Not that another church had opened. Not that another ministry had blossomed. Listen, I've told you all this. I could resign tomorrow and there would be people in line with a ministry license waiting to take my place. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Preachers are a dime a dozen, folks.
But
I'm called to preach. Ha ha, hurrah, hurrah. Good for you. Now, where is your heart?
Amen.
That's why in the book of Galatians, before they even released Paul, they told him, we want to make sure that you're going to take care of the poor. Why? Not because anything about theology or doctrine. We need a heart check.
Yes.
See, we're too quick not to let people up here because they chew Copenhagen, but they can be filled with lust, lies, pride, and greed. We let them carry all kinds of office. Learning to try and test the spirits.
Yes.
And it said in Mark 2 that it was noised abroad after some days that he was in the house. How are we going to pack this place out? First of all, we're going to do everything I told you to do. And starting today, Holy Spirit, you are invited here.
Amen. Amen.
From that, Holy Spirit, in you we find peace,
yes.
Life,
amen.
Healing, amen. Prosperity, salvation, and deliverance only,
yes.
From you.
From you.
And today we determine to build a house for the Lord that will perpetuate his kingdom. To see the fire and the glory of God fall.
Yes.
To restore to the body of Christ a reverential awe. My wife and I were talking about the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt, that whole generation that had been born in the wilderness. You know what their problem was? They never knew the slavery of Egypt. All they ever saw was the miracles of God. They seen water from rocks. They seen manna. They seen quail.
Right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
And then we have a generation now that we have come up on the purity of the doctrine of the word. And now God is saying to his body, but now I need to balance. Let's bring relationship.
Amen.
Let's bring motive and purity and intent of heart. Build the kingdom.